So welcome to Bat Biology 101. As you guys may remember, I am a bat biologist, and so I'm going to teach you a little bit about bats and bat biology. Learning objectives, recognize why bats are pretty much the coolest animals on the planet, and be able to support this by telling me at least 4 amazing facts about bats. And finally, be able to correct at least 4 common misconceptions or myths about bats. A lot of people have different ideas about bats, but might not know the real facts. So please enjoy. One of the first myths are that bats lay eggs. Bats are mammals, and mammals have hair, not feathers, and they bear live young, and they don't lay eggs. So they're more like us than they are birds, and they produce milk to feed their young. Here's just a random factoid from 2006. The tube-lipped nectar bat of Ecuador has the longest tongue relative to body size of any mammal. So notice this tongue is longer than the bat's actual body. This is a fantastic adaptation to get deep into a flower that has a long tube. And if you're the only one that can get in there, you end up with more nectar, and the plant gets more pollen moved around within the same species. So good example of mutualism. Another common myth is that bats are just flying rats. Bats are not flying rats. There are a couple characteristics that we use when we classify mammals, and one of those is the dentition, or the characteristics of the teeth. Right here we have a skull of a rat, and notice it's got these very large front incisors, no canines, and then flat molars. Here we have the skull of a bat, and it's got very, very small incisors and then sharp, big canines. So these teeth look a lot more like your cat than a rat. Lifespan is another significant difference between bats and rats. Myotis is one of the genus of bat species that live in our area, and they've been documented to live up to 30 years. So unlike a mouse or a rat, which is only going to live 2 or 3 years, these are a much longer lived group. In addition, going with longer life is they have a very different reproductive effort, which has to do with how many babies you have at a time. A typical mouse or rat is going to have a whole litter of pups, where a bat is going to have 1 or 2 babies, and that's going to happen only once a year. The typical bat body design is depicted here. The order of bats is the Chiroptera. Other orders would be the primates, the rodents, the carnivores. So Chiroptera means hand wing, and you can see where they got the name by looking at this picture. Their wing is actually just a great big hand. So here's the elbow, forearm, thumb, fingers, and then there's just webbing in between the fingers, and then also webbing between the tail and the hind legs. Here is a real bat. This is a red bat, and again you can see those parts: elbow, forearm, thumb, and fingers with webbing in between. Here you have the tail and the 2 hind legs. This is a pallid bat. This is actually the species that I did my thesis research on. I think that's the cutest little face ever. The order Chiroptera includes over 1,000 different species, and we continue to discover new species all the time. This is a group that is not particularly well studied. It is divided into 2 suborders. You have the megachiropterans, or the flying foxes, and then you have the microchiropterans, which is a smaller group. The megachiropterans, or the flying foxes, are the big bats that have these large puppy dog-like eyes and face. They're found only in Australia and Southeast Asia, so this isn't a kind of bat that we have around here. The biggest bats on the planet are going to be these flying foxes. And in one of my favorite words, they are all crepuscular. And crepuscular means they are active at both dawn and dusk. They don't have the ability to echolocate. These aren't nighttime bats flying around in caves in the dark. They also are all fruit eaters. You might look at this bat and think, wow, that's huge and a little bit scary, but it's only scary for guavas and other kinds of fruit, because that's all it's trying to eat. Of the 1,000 different species of bats, only less than 200 are the megachiropterans. So this is a pretty small percentage of the overall bat diversity on the planet. Microchiropterans are the bats that we find all over the world, including Australia and Southeast Asia, as well as throughout the United States. And this is what we typically think of as a bat, nocturnal echolocating organism. They're found everywhere in the world except Antarctica. Many are going to hibernate in the winter, and they're going to eat a huge variety of foods. And I've included these pictures just to show you some of the crazy up-close faces, ears, folds, all of these unique structures that you see on these bats up close. For the rest of this talk, I'll be speaking specifically about the microchiropterans, just because that's all we have around here, and so that's a little more relevant for California. Bats come in all shapes and sizes. The largest bat on the planet has a 6-foot wingspan. The smallest bat weighs less than a penny. Interestingly, both of these bats are found in the same place. They're found in Thailand. This large bat is a fruit bat. It's one of the megachiropterans. The smallest bat is sometimes called the bumblebee bat, and it actually would fit onto a quarter. It's that small. Here are some pictures of our local bats. This is one of the smallest bat. This is sort of a normal adult size hand, and this would be one of the larger bats in our area. When they're all folded up like this, they do look very small. I'll show you a picture of one of these hoary bats with its tail and wings spread out, and they do look quite a bit bigger. So another classic myth about bats is that bats are blind. Bats are not blind. They have similar vision to you and I. They can see some color, some black and white. But when they're flying around in the dark, they don't have some special kind of vision, and so they need some help. And what they do is they use something called echolocation. So when you echolocate, you send a ping of sound out. The sound waves hit things in your environment, they bounce back to your ears, and your brain is able to take those sound waves and translate that into a sound picture of the environment around you. The echolocation pitch is going to vary from about 15 to 150 kilohertz. For reference, our hearing cuts out at about 16 to 18 kilohertz. So there's a few bats we can actually hear a bit of their echolocation call, but most bats are echolocating too high for us to actually hear. Echolocation is actually very loud. They're up at 60, 70, 80 decibels, but again, it's too high pitched for us to actually hear. The pulse rate at which they emit their sounds is going to vary with the habitat they're in and the activity. If you are flying 1 mile up in the atmosphere, you're not going to run into very much and you don't have to send out very many sounds. If you are flying around the edge of an oak tree in a densely cluttered area and you're trying to catch moths, you're going to echolocate very quickly so that you can hone in on your food. So a lot of the crazy faces and ears that you see in microchiropterans are all about maximizing echolocation, particularly large ears and nose leaves. So if you have these large ears, you're able to capture sound waves as they come back. Notice they have this large formation here. This is called the tragus. You actually have a tragus in your ear. It's just a small little nub that protects the ear canal. But for these guys, it's actually serving the role of blocking the sound waves that are coming back to their ear. By blocking the sound waves by just a millionth of a second, it gives the brain more information about exactly where a sound came from. Nose leaves, these little protrusions coming off of their nose, or all of these folds, are all going to do a similar thing. They're going to break up how fast a sound wave is coming to his ear and help the bat discern exactly where the moth is in front of it. So bat biologists like myself take advantage of this echolocation, and we have something called bat detectors. And it's a fairly simple piece of equipment that's able to take high frequency sounds and divide those sounds down to a sound we can actually hear. And so you'll get a series of clicks from the bat detector. With the bat detector, we can run that sound through a computer and actually get a visual of a bat call. So each one of these sweeps is an individual sonar click, and from the physical characteristics of this call, we're able to narrow down what specific species is flying by this particular stock pond on this particular evening.